Trey Anastasio, welcome.
Thank you.
Why this? Why perform with an orchestra? Why have your songs performed by an orchestra?
Well, I studied composition in college, and I've always loved orchestral music. I see the Philharmonic regularly in New York. I live on the Upper West Side. And a lot of these pieces are large-scale pieces. They were modeled after an orchestral style of music.
You mean originally?
Originally. Yeah. Huh.
I mean, when you wrote them for Phish?
Yeah. So they're, you know, when I was in college, I was listening to Ravel and Stravinsky and the standard stuff. And I would write these large-scale pieces modeled, you know, on the Firebird or a piece like that. Uh-huh. I would have a melody that would come in at the end. My mentor and teacher was a guy named Ernie Stiers, who was a composer, and I studied with him for probably 5 or 6 years. And we would do big band arrangements, fugues, things like that. And a lot of that music crept into Phish.
All right, so you were influenced by classical music, you were a student of it, and it influenced your rock music as well.
Absolutely. If you listen to the first Phish record, it's pretty composed. A lot of the early Phish arrangements were, I would write a full arrangement, drums, bass, everything.
Really?
Every note, yeah.
Was there a moment where you thought you might be a classical musician or a classical composer?
I think my theory was, and this was, I was influenced by my mentor, like I said, who was almost like second father to me, Ernie Stiers, composer. And we used to talk a lot about the fact that we used to talk a lot about not getting so hung up on styles, but being much more focused on content, so that you could sneak harmonic elegance into rock and roll.
You felt that from the beginning?
From the beginning, absolutely. Again, if you went back and listened to the first Phish record, it's pretty obvious. Mm-hmm. And I love orchestral music. I go see the orchestra regularly, probably more than any other live music.
So what happens to the songs when you hear them with an orchestra? What they must change?
A bit. They don't change in form, but I work with Don Hart, the orchestrator that I work with is my friend Don Hart, and we've worked together for almost probably 10 years now. So we talk at length, many hours about each piece. We might say, well, this section sounds like Stefan Grappelli gypsy jazz. Mm-hmm. So maybe we can use the percussion instruments in that way, or that kind of stuff.
Because you want the orchestra actually doing something, right?
I mean,
this is not just a kind of pops where they're sawing, you know, back and forth.
We're rebelling against the standard pops concert.
You are.
The idea is to show off yes, very consciously from the beginning. There's no drum set, no electric bass, and I play very quietly. The idea is that there's nothing as rhythmically tight on God's green earth as an orchestra. The strings usually act in a percussive way, so we didn't want to put a drum set up there. There's nothing as harmonically elegant, and there's nothing as texturally elegant as an orchestra, and we wanted to take advantage of all those elements. And it was very important to us to write music that was challenging for the musicians, because they're so talented. You know, these are people who were the top of their class at Juilliard and then went on and tried out for the best orchestras in the world, and they're sitting up there, and we want to show them off to an audience that doesn't necessarily often see orchestras. So that's the idea. We'll see if it worked.
What have you learned about yourself, things about yourself as a musician in this process?
Oh, a lot. I can think of a lot of things offhand. One of the cool things about being the soloist with an orchestra is that you sit next to the concertmaster, who is ostensibly the best musician up there. And I've gotten to sit next to at least 5 great concert masters, 6, 7 now, probably. And just to hear how, you know, they'll own a phrase and you know, take a phrase that I might have played that then got written into the chart, and then they'll play it next to me with so much emotion and so much elegance. It's like being in school. Being up there. That's true with all the musicians.
But this sense of what you're calling the elegance of an orchestra and what classical music can do, you've had this since at least college yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where did that come from?
Well, I'm trying to think that there were two big music lovers in my family. My mother was an enormous lover of Broadway. She grew up in the 40s and 50s in the city and got to see the golden age of Broadway. So she used to play lots and lots of original cast albums, yeah. South Pacific, West Side Story. Mm-hmm. So that was probably my first introduction into, you know, the idea, the concept that you could take a beautiful pop song and combine it with harmonic elegance, because mm-hmm. that's what all that stuff was. Mm-hmm. That had a big influence. My grandfather was also a huge classical music fan, and he gave me his record collection when he left me his record collection when he passed away. He had season tickets to the New Haven concert series, mm-hmm. and he used to tell me about seeing Rachmaninoff in person.
Really? And
stories like that. Yeah. They would go every week. Yeah. So those are probably the two people that really brought orchestral music into my life. Mm-hmm.
Now the National Symphony, the New York Philharmonic, the LA Philharmonic, all these orchestras you're playing with, they are not jam bands, right?
Oh, no, no.
You can't, whenever you see Phish, it's always, it's jam, the jam band Phish.
Right.
Explain what is a jam band?
Define. The funny thing was that when we started, people used to call us a progressive band, like uh-huh. prog rock almost, because there were so many long segments of composed music. A lot of it was heavily composed, right. heavily composed. Like I said, there were some songs where I would chart out the entire band, drum yeah. parts and everything. Yeah. We also improvised. But now we improvise a lot.
Yeah, and that's the jam.
That's the jam, I yeah. guess. So it was a little of each.
Mm-hmm. And how does that work? I mean, on stage, how much of it is prepared, and how much of it is happening, unfolding on stage?
Well, there's composed sections and then free sections. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we used to do as a band with Phish is that we would do jamming exercises.
Jamming.
We didn't
exercises.
Want it to be a big mush of you know, navel gazing. Self-indulgent uh-huh. solos.
You wanted organized.
We
jamming.
Wanted organized jamming. Yeah. Yes. So we would do very elaborate listening exercises where we would go around in a circle, and each musician would start a phrase, and then the other three would have to join in harmony or rhythmically, and make a sort of a you know, hand and glove kind of thing, and then the focus would shift to the next person in line. They would institute a phrase. So it was listening and playing exercises. And then they got subsequently more and more elaborate. So we're jamming, but we're listening a lot. We're trying to listen.
So it's sort of studying and learning improvisation.
Yes, as a group.
Yeah,
we're kind of funny that way. We're currently working on a new album. We're doing the same thing with lyrics. Everything's a group.
But so at this stage, when you're up on when you're giving a concert, do you know beforehand much about what's going to come out or how long a song is going to last? Or
over the years, no. Over the years, it's become freer. But see, the thing about it to me is that it's important. The way I see it, the freedom comes with an enormous amount of discipline first. There's lots and lots of hidden work and practicing that gets you to the point where you can play like that.
Well, explain so that. People probably don't know that, right?
Yeah, that I don't know that they do.
Yeah.
With Phish, we still do, actually. But I was going to say, we used to practice. We were addicted to practicing. We would practice long, long hours. And we would practice improvising. And we would talk at length about volumes and about tempo shifts mm-hmm. and about a certain person in the band might not... It might be being left behind or something. So what we would do is we'd sit in the band practice room, and like, let's say Paige, our keyboard player, was not as aggressive a personality. We would encourage him to be in the band practice room. So we'd say, you lead us for the next 5 minutes or something like that. And
just to
take us into a
there,
new key. Yeah. Well, let's shift keys spontaneously. You shift keys and we're going to see if we can hear that you're doing it and go with you. Things like that. Purposely speed up and slow down. Rush the tempo and drag the tempo. We used to do rushing and dragging tempo exercises in a circle. It would be each person's turn to drag. And if they dragged, we would have to go with them fearlessly. And if they rushed, we'd go with them fearlessly. So a lot of it had to do with being in a group of people and coexisting and being a community. And our idea was always that that would then, that message would spread out. And I think it has, that the Phish scene is a community. But we try to be a community with the four of us too. But there is a lot of discipline, a lot more discipline than it might seem.
There's a lot of discipline, but you want it to feel spontaneous.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And it is, in a sense.
Yes.
But it's a disciplined spontaneity. Am I saying that right?
Yes. Without sounding ridiculous, and I'm going to sound ridiculous here because it's just a rock band and we're having fun in its essence. But if you think about any music is, in its essence, a spiritual. I don't think there's anything funny about that at all. I know that. Mm-hmm. And a spiritual undertaking. Music. And all spiritual practices require a lot of discipline. Mm-hmm. You don't just, whether it's meditation or whatever you want to do, you don't just sit down and reach enlightenment with your legs crossed because you know what I mean?
Right.
Lit some incense. Sure. If you really look at it, martial arts, any of them, any kind of art requires thousands, literally thousands of hours of discipline. And so that's certainly the case with what we're doing here. You know, sometimes I'll walk up on stage with an orchestra and I'll just think about the combined hours of hard work that went into this moment of 70, 80, 90 people playing perfectly in harmony. All these people spent their entire life preparing for this moment. Thousands and thousands of hours of practicing, learning to play rhythmically tight, learning to play in tune, learning to check their ego at the door.
But when you play with an orchestra, you can't, the jam part of it can't, is no longer there, right?
No, not really. There is a little bit of improvising, but not much.
Yeah. Do you miss that?
No. I like to be part of a group. We built this orchestral show, We built this orchestral show where the guitar is integrated into the orchestra like any other orchestral instrument for the most part. Mm-hmm. So the biggest song, the biggest piece of the night, Time Turns Elastic, started off with me writing the form. I wrote the form, and then when Don orchestrated it, sections that I came up with on the guitar, we talked about this. I said, take it off the guitar, put it into the orchestra, and then write the guitar lines in as you would any other orchestral instrument. So, you know, you're trading the guitar with the woodwinds and that kind of thing. Maybe the octaves with the strings.
Yeah.
But it feels amazing to be part of such a huge, gorgeous sound and to really be integrated into it.
You know, you've said several times about liking to be part of a group and the groupness of Phish and the groupness of playing with an orchestra. I guess a lot of us think about rock and roll as sort of a, you know, out there personality, like, well, the rock star.
Right. Right?
Is that just not that your personality?
It doesn't really work for me.
It doesn't?
No. I music to me was always a pathway to community and to belonging to something. I think when I was young, the sense that I always had was I wanted to be part of something. So my musical friends were, that was my social life. Mm-hmm. And that was sort of the model for me going forward was that socializing, having fun, laughing, always revolved around music. So my friends and I would go to parties and write songs in the back room. You know, we were just talking about it last week because Phish is celebrating our 30th anniversary. we were talking about how lucky we feel to be part of such a loving community, and that means the audience as well as the mm-hmm. as the band members. A lot of the people who come see us have been coming for 20, 30 years.
And they come many times.
And I know them. I mean, I don't know by name, but there's people that I look out and see that I really genuinely feel a connection to.
Really?
Absolutely. Huh. And I have, as strange as this sounds, relationships with people who stand like 10 rows back and dance that I recognize, that I walk on stage and I say hi, and it's a good feeling.
Really?
And
I
mean, start playing. I've never spoken a word to them.
You feel you have a relationship? I mean, that strikes me as sounding unusual for a rock band.
Yeah, well, I know it sounds weird, but it's the dead on truth.
And what's the relationship?
It feels like a healthy expression of, you know, joy and celebration. Or I really noticed it. I did 4 shows with my solo band out west, and there were people that were there all 4 nights. And by the 4th night, a couple of people I was looking at, and they were kind of smiling back at me, and I was just thinking, you know, this is I mean, everybody wants to belong to something. You know, everyone wants to be included. And music to me has been a pathway to community and kind of a welcoming, you know, an inclusive atmosphere mm-hmm. where people can express themselves and be part of something in a healthy way. And if you talk about this orchestral shows, that's what they feel like to me in the same way, especially because when I first walk in, inevitably some people in the orchestra are going to think, oh no, here comes the guitar guy,
right,
rolling their eyes a little bit. And I don't blame them. I don't blame them one bit. That's not a judgment. Yeah. That's just an observation. Yeah. Once the thing gets going, usually by the 2nd rehearsal, the atmosphere changes to, wow, this is challenging. This is music that celebrates all the musicians consciously, on purpose, was written to elevate and celebrate this amazing orchestra. And when the audience comes in, the way they react usually is a bit of a surprise to some of the people in the orchestra too. Like, they really get involved.
The audience, you know, the song will end, right.
And there's a big roar, and the orchestra stands up, and everybody genuinely, and, you know, sometimes you'll see the people in the orchestra kind of, whoa.
it's pretty big. Not like our normal performance, right?
Yeah. I've seen lots and lots of performances, you know, the Philharmonic in New York, where I saw Kurt Mazur conduct one day, guest conduct, and walk on. And, I've never seen anything so beautiful in my life. It was, transformed. You know, I've seen the orchestra many times at performances. Orchestras transform, you know, the air into.
But let me ask you about this sense of community that you're talking about. Is that what explains the large following that you and that Phish has? And this very intense relationship, right? People following you from city to city
for
many years. You think that's what it is?
The 4 of us are in Phish. It's so important to us that we're communicating. We're, you know, communicating is the ultimate goal. So we have built this music and you know, the family that exists with our road manager and our there's a big infrastructure that travels with us. You know, we want to be respectful and inclusive. It's important. And we want every band member to be celebrated. And there's no extra parts. Mm-hmm. So maybe that message gets... is in the air and people pick up on it, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, like when I'm playing with Phish or when I'm playing with any of the bands that I play with, you know, I watch the audience all night and I want people to have a good time. Or I want people to be in a state of release, you know? And it makes me, you know, it's a reason for living for me. It's if I see somebody lit up in the audience, I mean, that's enough for me. It's not really about the band playing well or I want to see somebody, you know, momentarily released from the drudgery of, you know, normal life.
Really?
I mean that with all sincerity.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's probably the underlying theme to all these musical projects. Because it was that for me. You know, music saved my life when I was young.
You mean literally?
Yes, literally. And when I was old, actually. But it's always sort of been there for me when things are going wrong. I mean, I still, to this day, get up in the morning and, you know, go running with headphones on and listen to music. And I love music. And it's always been a healthy, you know, escape for me and parachute when things are going wrong. If I can provide a tiny bit of that for somebody else, nothing could make me happier.
But you do, I mean, you could do that just by playing with Phish. And now here we watch you with an orchestra. Last year you did a Broadway musical, right?
Yeah.
You're doing all kinds of projects. So why all that? Where does that come from?
Well, one, it feels good to be, I always like to keep in the child mind, I mean childlike but not childish, meaning a beginner's mind. Uh-huh. I like learning. I like being the beginner.
You do?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I like the challenge. I like getting up in the morning and learning something new. But all of those outlets, the Broadway show, the orchestra, they all offer... Only an orchestra can do what an orchestra does. You can't get that playing with Phish. Mm-hmm. Not even close. And, you know, when you get that number of people of that talent playing acoustically and, you know, intermingling in the air in a beautiful hall, there's nothing like it in the world. And the same thing with the Broadway play. It's telling a story. It's not in my voice. We could write songs through the eyes of other people and really delve into their personalities. So they all kind of offer something. They each offer something unique and a way to get to emotional levels that we probably couldn't with Phish or with a solo band or whatever. The other thing is you learn stuff that you then take back to Phish.
Oh, really? It works that way?
Definitely.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, because, but when you stand in that spot next to the podium and an orchestra is playing, the sound is...
It's pretty amazing.
Oh, my God. It's in 3D and it's coming in every direction. Yeah. My knees get weak.
Really?
Sometimes they'll hit a chord and when they really, they're rhythmically tight enough. It's harmonized perfectly.
And you say that as someone who's been in big arenas with, you know, lots of amplification, but this is something special.
This is wood.
Yeah.
And this is wood and metal vibrating and 100-year-old, many, many hundreds of year-old instruments. And, you know, with these incredibly talented musicians emoting. And when you've heard that sound, when you get into another context, you want that level of emotional content. So you search for it in other ways. So you might be in a big arena and there's some kind of music going on or some kind of guitar solo or something. And I think, wow, I wish I could get to that level that I heard with the, you know, Pittsburgh Symphony that night when the brass section was playing that way, that kind of thing. So, you know, it opens your mind.
Well, I was just thinking about, as you were talking about 30 years with Phish, you have been a working musician through a period of incredible change in the music industry.
That's for
right?
sure.
Technology, how music is produced, mm-hmm. how it's disseminated. Where do you think we are? And I know you've been involved with this too, is like encouraging music online, right? And getting music out and thinking about these things. Where do you think we are? Are you worried about new bands today and how they can find an economic model? And
I sympathize with new bands very much so today. I do think it's hard today to get, because it takes, like I said before, it takes so many thousands of hours to get your act together. Mm-hmm. Did you ever read this book, Outliers, by Malcolm Gladwell?
Oh, I know of it, yeah. I didn't read it.
He makes a really good point that when the Beatles hit in 1964, they had done literally thousands of hours of playing as a band in Hamburg. They had their act together. They also happened to be the greatest band of all time and all that. But his point in the book was that it takes 10,000 hours to become a master of anything. Right. So I don't know how many hours you've been doing your job, but you didn't just walk in here and know how to negotiate an interview right. and to get people to talk openly. That takes time. Right. So the problem with one of the problems for a young band today is that you have to get out on stage and play and make mistakes in order to improve. And if there's no viable financial model, it does make it a lot harder. Phish started in Burlington, Vermont in 1983. There were more bars per capita in Burlington than anywhere in America, and that was the year that the drinking age changed.
So, is there a connection to the
very
start
much so.
Of the band? Yeah.
It was grandfathered. Everyone in Vermont was the last state to change the drinking age.
Yeah.
So I was 18. That's why there were so many bars. There aren't more bars in Burlington today. Mm-hmm. That was the last 3 years that there were. There were 53 bars in a small town. Every bar wanted a band. Mm-hmm. So when you got a gig in Burlington in 1983, it was for three nights, three sets. I mean, we played like 6 hours a night. We played.
Yep.
And the owner of the bar that we used to play in would come up to us and say, play a slow one, play a fast one, play a cover, play a Beatles cover. Yeah. Because there was no cover. We were just the band in the corner.
Right.
We got really good at playing live. Yeah. And I think if we weren't in the right place at the right time, I don't know if any of this would have happened.
Huh. So that's how you got your chops together, just by doing it.
Yes. Yeah. It's probably hard for a young band right now to break through that. But I will say one thing here. There's no free ride, you know?
Meaning?
Sometimes I think people think they're going to get into music because it's a way to not work, which is completely the opposite of the way that I've always looked at it. You know, that if you love it, you're going to get up at 7 every day and play all day long and work and find gigs. And so
your sense is that people think of it, well, it's what, the celebrity aspect to it, or it's just easy?
If that's what you think, it's not going to last.
Yeah.
A couple of years ago, I got to do two shows warming up for the Stones. And let me tell you, there is no harder working band on God's green earth. And they didn't just stay the biggest rock band in the world for 40 years by luck.
So this is a job. I mean, it's something
job.
To work at.
You got to love it.
You got to put in your 10,000 hours.
You got to put in your 10,000 hours.
And then you got to keep working.
And then you got to put in another 10,000 hours. But, you know, if you love it, which I do, it's easy. It's everything else in life that's it's hard.
All right, Trey Anastasio, thanks for talking to us.
Thank you so much.
Okay.